always missed it. No, I felt that after all the classes.
What she said, she has gone through, she has actually a lot of exposure to spirituality. So after coming through my classes, she was able to get the crux of spirituality in a short form. So this is actually, okay, in life, it is very difficult to get a master who can give you the essence of spirituality and glimpse of what is required in a very short way. That is the greatest grace in the world. The greatest grace God can give to you is to take you to a master who can give you. The God only will come in the form of master, guru. Okay. Guru and God, Sadguru and God, they are not different. So greatest fortune in life is to meet such master. So once you meet the master, what will happen? You are, all learning will become redundant. So now you get the crux of the matter very quickly. I mean, to give an example, a student is searching for a PhD problem. Okay, he studied so many books and all. But by thinking he is sitting in a plane and the next guy is sitting a Nobel laureate. This guy doesn't know he is Nobel laureate. They are discussing. Says, I am looking at this. Then the Nobel laureate says, why don't you look at that? Then it suddenly strikes to him, because all those struggle the Nobel laureate has already done. He is only pointing to him what is to be undone. So he is quickly going. The guru is like a person who has done already the background work for you. You don't have to go through. But you should have a trust in him. Okay? You should have faith in him. And you should be able to receive that last.
Shishya should be ready also.
Ready. That you should have that readiness to receive that. To readiness to receive that. That means if you are ready to receive that, it's available to you on the platter. See, actually a person who is mature, okay, realization doesn't take time at all. The moment he meets the master, it's over, practically, okay? But that maturity process, how much you mature, you are the question. That's called sadhana chatushtaya. Some people are mature because of their past life itself. We don't know. They may not have done anything in this life, but past life itself, they are done. They are just right, waiting for the right moment to happen. Sometimes people do the put effort. We don't know whose background is what. It is like saying, okay, do you get headache? And what do you take a capsule?
Yeah.
What capsule do you take? How much does it cost you?
2 rupees.
The crocin tablet costs you 2 rupees. Now tell me, what is the chemical composition of the crocin? What is the formula for crocin?
Paracetamol.
What is the paracetamol, right, the chemical compound? You don't know, but still your headache is going. Why? To find that chemical compound, okay, hundreds of scientists spending billions of dollars work on that to find that one formula which will remove your headache. And the hundreds of scientists and billions of dollars of worth effort, you get it 2 rupees. You don't really spend that. Like that, lot of work has been done in terms of Vedanta, spiritual teaching in India, traditions, lot of work. I mean, it's thousands and thousands of man years of effort has gone in terms of rishis and many sadhakas. Okay? And that effort has to be delivered to you as a small capsule. That has to be done by the guru. Okay? Now, this guru also himself has done a lot of effort to eliminate what is not possible. The guru's success is not realization. Guru's success is failure. He knows what all things will fail. Then he knows this will work. And that capsule he delivers to you. So that's why you don't have to go through all the struggle. You take the capsule and go. But the problem is, you should have faith in the guru to take the capsule. Clear? It is like this, my dear. You have a stomachache. Okay? The moment you have stomachache, you try home remedies. Eat something. It doesn't work. Then your friend comes. Hey, why don't you try this? She gives a tablet. You don't take the tablet. You don't know what will happen, the effect of tablet. Then you go to a medical shop. I have stomachache. He will give some tablet. Then you don't have confidence that he will take it or not. Then you go to a doctor. He gives the same tablet. Now you take it. stomach is gone. The tablet is same, but coming from where it makes a difference. Okay, the trusted source called Guru, once he gives a small tablet, that will solve your problem. But the question is, do you have the trust? The second question is, does he have the qualification? The problem is, in any field, there's a qualification, engineering, medical degree. Guru, what is the qualification?
He should be realized.
How do you know somebody's realized? How do you find out somebody's realized?
What is important?
Right. Question is, I'm not realized. How do I know somebody else is realized? So then what happens? People fall for external propaganda. Okay, they will go through some formula. Okay, one formula I'll tell you. Somebody has to be enlightened. The depth of enlightenment is proportional to the length of his beard. So the guru with longest beard has more deeper enlightenment. Okay, this is one formula people apply. The other formula is, the guru is actually has a divya drishti. That means he is able to see what is going on in my head. Okay, so somebody who is there look for supernatural powers. Then guru is, he has a special eyes. Yeah, that guru has a special eyes. He is looking always upwards. Okay. So like all superficial character, we start looking, not the depth. And problem for us is, we don't know what is depth. Because ourselves, we are not in a position to evaluate somebody. Then we go by references, we go to external this thing. But to you start getting the depth, okay, because of kicks in life. Finally, you say, this is what a guru I am looking for. That time, guru appears in life. Because that guru was always there in front of you or behind you. You are not able to recognize. Guru appears in front of you when you are able to recognize. Okay? That's what happens. A maturity is required in you to get a guru. Otherwise, yatha guru, tatha shishya. So what happens? You start looking for a quality of whatever quality you have, you start looking in guru. I have a desire, the guru will promise you some gold. Guru will promise you some magic. That's why the lot of tamasha goes on in the world. A guru should have his own realization. Okay? His own realization, he has to have a realization. Now this realization should be in tune with the knowledge of Vedanta. Because anybody can come and say, I have a realization. It should be in tune with, it cannot be totally violating what other people have realized. Something new cannot be found. Then he should be having, not only these two, he should have the ability to communicate to you. Okay? So if these things are not met, the person cannot be guru. Three things. His own realization, coming through his own effort, sadhana. Second thing is, the realization should be in tune with the teachings of Vedanta. Then third thing is, ability to teach. If two things are there but ability to teach is not there, then also he cannot be a guru. Then he can be called a saint, sage. People do namaskara, get some blessing and go. A guru should have the ability to teach. That's called yukti, the teaching methodology. He should have wisdom. And he should have been... He need not remember all the scriptures. But what he preaches should be in tune with the scriptures. Ramakrishna Paramahamsa never read any scriptures. But whatever he speaks is what is Vedanta. Like that. So it doesn't mean that I am speaking of a scholar. I am speaking of somebody who speaks the truth. The truth is not different from somebody else who has found the truth. That's called... So these three things are required for a person who is called a realized master.
What do we call in Sanskrit for this? Ability to communicate?
One is called Brahmanishta. Shrotriya Brahmanishta. Then ability to communicate, I have not found the right word. He has actually, typically it's called Yukti.
Yukti.
Yeah. Okay, teaching methodology is called Yukti. Technique. Okay, now the Yukti is a truth, can be taught in many ways. Okay, so that teaching methodology is unique to the teacher. Normally, yukti in a traditional Vedantic teaching, they say it is a parampara. Paramparagatavagi, it comes from a tradition. Okay, the traditional teaching is a methodology. Okay? This is a systematic way of teaching, like this, like this, like this. A typically realized person can take a completely new method of teaching. Not necessarily with the tradition. The essence is same, but method of teaching is applicable to the society. So that is called yukti. Okay? This yukti is not mentioned in the tradition. The yukti is not actually, the tradition they give, Brahmanishta, Shrotriya. Brahmanishta means one is realized. Shrotriya means one who has knowledge of scriptures. And parampara, there is a parampara for this thing, guru parampara. So this is what is required. Yukti is skill. Okay? For example, what tradition Ramana Maharshi comes from? There's no tradition. He sometimes says, I don't have a tradition. Okay, but he has a yukti, technique. The technique is, who are you? Okay, only one line, but it's very powerful teaching. That's called yukti. Okay, so, but if you trace Ramana Maharshi teaching, it's all Advaita teaching. Okay, he's whatever he says, Advaita. But he doesn't say, I am Advaita. He says, who are you? That's all his question. That's yukti. That's a teaching technique, because by going to specific point, he is avoiding all unnecessary conversation. Otherwise, you start getting into this dispute, that dispute, this Advaita, this tradition, this path, and all those things. It just straight away goes to the point, which is your problem. Who are you? That's called yukti. Okay? So then there's a tradition of teaching also. For example, Shankaracharya's tradition has some teaching methodology. There is a specific teaching, this you have to teach, this you have to teach, this prakriya you have to do, and all this teaching methodology. There's a tradition. But a realized person need not have any tradition. He can evolve on his own technique. One methodology, which is completely different, but always in tune with the teaching. That's called yukti. For example, Buddha, he went for teaching. He used to go for bhiksha. 40 years of life, being a king, he spent 40 years of life in wandering. And his purpose of bhiksha was not bhiksha. His purpose of bhiksha, he go to the bhiksha, ask for bhiksha, and give a teaching to that person. Okay, he went to bhiksha for giving teaching, not for taking bhiksha. And he had a technique also. He had yukti. Buddha was very smart. Okay, he got away with this thing. So he goes to a farmer's house. Bhiksha. So farmer comes and gives bhiksha. So Buddha asks, how is your crop? Farmer says, this time rain is not good. Okay. Oh, rain is uncertain. No, Buddha said. Rain is uncertain. See, life is also like that, uncertainty will start. So from where you are, yukti is from where you are, the master is able to take you where you have to be. Okay? Understand? You are here and take where you have to be. And master can take anywhere you are to take to where you are. That's called yukti. Whereas tradition requires a standardization. Tradition is school system. This is the input, this is the output. Input you have qualified? Sadhana chatushtaya? This is the input. Now you go to step number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, you are out. That is the tradition. That's called parampara. A yukti, the master will say, okay, where you are, he will find out. Okay, then say, okay, let's start where you are. And then he will take you where master wants. That's the difference between yukti and parampara.
Guru identifies disciple.